Okay. Thank you very much, Sanel. Thank you very much, Henry, for finding time to spend discussing your work, the impact of your career on all of us. And Barbara, thank you very much for being the technological support system in the background for Henry Widdowson. I want to begin by framing this conversation in a more informal way. Assuming, Henry, that I was fortunate enough to talk about the impact of your views on applied linguistics to some undergraduate students or graduate students who know very little about applied linguistics, what would you say when you look back are the key points that stand out in terms of how your ideas have the impact of those ideas? Which of those various many different ideas are critically important in how you have been framed over the years? You may disagree with the way they frame you, but what image about yourself keeps coming back when you're talking about, when people are talking about your work?
Yeah. yes, you mentioned in the questions you sent me that you were interested in the story of my scholarly life,
yes,
and what I saw to be the influences upon it, and which scholars that I encountered were influenced my own thinking. You mentioned in our informal talk before this session began, yes, that you were that I was your external examiner when you did an MSc in Edinburgh. And this is in 87. And my scholarly life also started in Edinburgh way back in 1964, when I too enrolled as a student in those days for a diploma in applied linguistics. At that time, this was in October 64, I was rather late coming on the academic scene. Pitt Corder had just been appointed as a new director of applied linguistics. And when I returned, I can mention later where I'd gone, but I then I was working with the British Council at the time. I'll talk about that a bit later, perhaps. When I returned 4 years later to do a PhD, Pitt was my supervisor.
Oh, okay.
So Pitt was the first scholar to get me thinking about applied linguistics. But his field of research, which is error analysis, was of no particular interest to me. I think was influential about him was not what he thought about error analysis. But how he thought about it, how his mind worked. And he was, Pitt was never really an empirical researcher. He used data to spark off ideas, right? And his thinking was essentially philosophical, I think. He was primarily interested in exploring basic concepts. He was interested in ideas. I mean, extremely intellectually curious person.
Yes.
And that influenced me a good deal, because it seemed to chime in mm-hmm. with the way my own mind works. Mm-hmm. So I suppose that the scholars that subsequently influenced me mm-hmm. when I was pursuing my PhD study were influential because they got me thinking, I suppose one could say. Mm-hmm. It wasn't because of the kind of answers they provided, but so much as the questions they raised. So their influence was not that I accepted their ideas,
yes.
But they inspired me to subject their ideas, if you like, mm-hmm. in particular appraisal. So my thinking tended always to be reactive. Mm-hmm. And the scholars that I reacted to in this way were mm-hmm. People like Michael Halliday, for example, Del Hines, mm-hmm. William Leboff, John Searle, mm-hmm. moving from the social to the philosophical dimension, if you like, Paul Grice. Mm-hmm. I got very interested in what they had to say. Mm-hmm. And many of them figured in my PhD and indeed in my subsequent work. So these scholars keep on cropping up. and I keep on returning to them to explore their significance. Indeed, the first paper in the mm-hmm. book was mentioned as my latest publication, mm-hmm. Was about the scholar who was in many ways the first who inspired me into critical thinking, and that was J.R. Firth.
Oh, okay.
J.R. Firth, when I began my scholarly life in Edinburgh in 64, was very much out of fashion. His way of thinking about language had fallen out of fashion. In fact, it had fallen out of fashion in rather a dramatic way. A moment of historical change. And I think this is also relevant because my arrival in Edinburgh in 64 not only coincided with Pitt Corder's arrival as the director of the school, or the, as it was then, Department of Applied Linguistics, but it also coincided with the arrival of John Lyons as the first professor of the newly founded Department of General Linguistics. Up to then, linguistics had been carried out by Angus McIntosh in the English department, by Michael Halliday, Peter Strevens was also there, there was this establishment of a new chair of general linguistics, and John Lyons was the first professor. It had been assumed that Michael Halliday would be, because he was always also already in situ, but it was John Lyons, the outsider, so to speak, who took the chair. So up to then, it was Michael Halliday who was the prevailing influence in Edinburgh. But John Lyons changed all that, because he was an enthusiastic advocate of this new enlightenment of generative linguistics. And it was that became the dominant paradigm in Edinburgh, and of course in many other places as well. So I remember we spent a lot of time talking about developments in generative grammar, the more recent ideas that had cropped up from Michigan and so on. But I was never really much taken with these notions. I was more influenced in my ideas about language I was more influenced by the line of thinking that Chomsky had displaced. And this was a line of thinking which Michael Halliday had inherited from his teacher, and his teacher was J.R. Firth. So the Firthian influence on thinking about language was displaced in a way in Edinburgh and in many other parts of the world, of course, by the line of thought that really J.R. Firth had originated. So it was Firth's ideas that first appealed to me, and which I first sort of reacted to, if you like. And his influence was I suppose, born of frustration, because the idea that, the basic idea that Firth took strong exception to what he called the static formalism of de Saussure. And he proposed that the study of language should be completely different, but it should be concerned, as he called it, with linguistic events in the social process. And introduced this concept, the schema, as he called it, of the context of situation, where language was essentially the study of the localized interaction of various factors. And he outlined these factors in this, what he called his schema of context of situation, which came originally from the anthropologist Malinowski. Right? That's where Firth originally got the idea. And the interesting thing for me at the time, it's an interest that has been retained, I think, is that this outline in the context of situation, as he called it, referred to the relevant features of the participants, the verbal action and the non-verbal action of the participants, the relevant objects, as he called them, and the effect of the verbal action. Now this idea, this schema, provoked me into thinking about how it could be, because it was frustrating because Firth never went on to clarify or explain what he meant about with these terms, particularly the term relevant. Mm-hmm. What are the relevant features of participants? What are the relevant features of the situation? What are the relevant features of the nonverbal actions? What is relevant about the language? He just concept of relevance was extremely well there. It could be open to almost any interpretation. So this I found provocative. How could you make this notion of relevant more precise and coherent as a framework, right, for the description of how language is put to communicative use? And then, naturally enough, I became influenced by scholars who seemed to me to provide something of this precision or of this clarification, where Firth's vague list of factors in the context of situation and notions of relevance became that's more specific. They are, for example, in Searle, in Searle's identification of conditions for the performance of speech acts, are really a more precise formulation of the concept of relevance that Firth was referring to. Hines' speaking model, you know, this celebrated speaking model, is a more, I think, exact formulation of Firth's context of situation. And these ideas, of course, developed in the early 70s. And by then, interestingly, Firth's communicative perspective on language had become an alternative orthodoxy, basically, in opposition to generative linguistics. Labov in 72 talks about the object of linguistics being ultimately the instrument of communication used by the speech community. And he said that if we're not talking about that, there's something essentially trivial in our proceeding. So this consigns generative grammar to triviality, because this was the abstract formalism, precisely the abstract formalism that Firth was opposing and tried to counteract. You see this development. In fact, it was in 1957 that Firth published his Papers in Linguistics, an article in a paper in that volume called Personality and Language and Society. He outlines his context of situation and talks about his particular, this view of language study as being concerned with social events in the social process. And in, of course, exactly the same year, in 1957, with syntactic structures. So you've got this very neat date, if you like. So the reason I'm mentioning all this is that it seems to me that my sort of, the story of my scholarship, in a way, on the story of my scholarly life, relates to these two crucial dates, 1957 and 1964. It was the notion of context of situation, how you could not only clarify but operationalize for descriptive. For description, the very vague formulation that Firth had. Because Firth was extremely vague in a way that Chomsky was extremely precise, which I found very interesting. I mean, if Chomsky can be precise about formal linguistics, is there some way in which you can be precise or more precise about the kind of functional communicative language study that Firth had in mind? I can't hear you.
Good question. When you look back at the time you were in Edinburgh before you moved on, how did Edinburgh manage to balance the potential incompatibility between individuals who might have been interested in much more empirical, let's say, language testing work, and then the more philosophical orientation work that came from what Pete Koda, et cetera, and other people were interested in? Were there people who some of us might not know, who were attempting to balance these tendencies within the department?
I don't think so. I think that I'm trying to think of my people, because then subsequently I myself became a member of staff in the department from 68. Yes. When I did my diploma in 64, the influence of Chomsky hadn't really taken root. Because John Lyons had only just been appointed and just worked. And Halliday, who had been expected to get the chair, then left Edinburgh. And so, and so indeed did Peter Strevant. There were people who were still in Britain as well. There were people who were still very, very much influenced by a Firthian line, particularly as it was developed by Michael Halliday, and that tradition was still there, but it was much overshadowed, I think. As Palmer put it, it was first ideas could not resist the invasion, and this is Frank Palmer's expression, the invasion of this new orthodoxy from the United States, from Michigan.
Now, let me then move you, take you over again, to continue with the Edinburgh period. I think you had left, and then Pete Calder left, and then Alan Davis took over as head for some time.
Yes.
Yeah. What direction was he trying to take Edinburgh Applied Linguistics to? Intellectually, what was his intellectual project? Because Alan seems to have had the language testing part of him, but I think he was least exciting when he was talking about language testing. He was more exciting when he was talking about anything else in applied linguistics, other than language testing.
Yes.
And philosophically, what I found interesting was that he was a much better thinker than he was a language tester.
Yes. Well, I think that, I mean, I of course had left Edinburgh, but that's because when I left Edinburgh, Pitt was still, of course, he'd become professor of applied linguistics.
Yeah.
But it sounds to me, from what you say, as if Alan, being interested in ideas and the analysis of concepts and so on, rather than the methodology of testing,
is
very much, I think, In the Pitt tradition. Pitt always encouraged people to think.
Yes.
And to really to be, I suppose, positively skeptical.
Mm-hmm.
And to as I said earlier, he had an interest in ideas.
Mm-hmm.
And whenever he encountered the work of any particular scholar, his immediate reaction, I think, was to ask questions about it rather than accept. Sounds to me, I mean, I don't know because I wasn't there, of course, but that Alan was of that cast of mind, so to speak.
Yeah, good. Okay, let me then continue with the questions and so that we can continue with our conversation. You then left Edinburgh, you went to London, and then you went to Vienna. When you look at all those series of movements, what events, for example, at the London School in London, shaped your thinking about applied linguistics when you were now in London? How did your stay in London shape your understanding and practices of applied linguistics?
Randolph Quirk was running the. He was at University College, and people like Neil Smith were pursuing the generative line. Randolph was involved in the description of English, of course, and he had people like Jeff Leach. Who basically, I think, followed a Halliday on the line. I don't think my own thinking was greatly influenced by that. I think I need to go back before I went to Edinburgh, actually. The reason why the context of situation, I think, was so interesting to me was that it was because of my experiences when I was in the British Council. Because, as I said earlier, I came late to the academic scene, and I spent 8 or 10 years. Previous to that, overseas. My first job was at the University of Indonesia as a lecturer in English literature. And what struck me about that was that the literature course in Jakarta was. Exactly the same kind of course as it would be anywhere else in the world, and a replication of English literature courses in British universities. So I went to Indonesia with ideas in my head that teaching English literature was done in the same way as literature had been taught to me when I was a Cambridge undergraduate. Which meant, you know, that you taught the Shakespearean tragedy, and you taught a bit of Chaucer, even maybe throw in a bit of Old English. You drew on the established canon of English literature, which was drawn on in universities in Britain. Without concern for what the relevance might be to the lives of the students that I was teaching. Again, the notion of relevance. It didn't occur to me at the time to ask about the relevance question. I mean, I was there to teach English literature, and there was one way of teaching literature, and there was a canon of English literature you taught, and you did that wherever you were, whatever university you found yourself in whatever part of the world. And I still find this is the case, that a course in English literature in Hong Kong appears to be the same as a course of English literature in Beijing or in Vienna, indeed. There seems to be very little realization that maybe you shape a course of English literature in a way that is contextually relevant to the particular experiences and understanding and knowledge of your students. And then when I went, I then joined the British Council and became an English language officer, where I was supposed to be advising the inspectorate and the colleges of education about the teaching of English. I had absolutely no qualification for doing so, but except that I was a native speaker. And in those days, I'm still, being a native speaker with sufficient qualification for teaching the language. And again, it seemed that it raised the basic question, well, if that English literature is English literature wherever you are, and the English language is the English language wherever you are. This seemed to be the basic idea, so that the whole approach to the teaching was replication. But then in Dhaka, interestingly, in Dhaka, the teacher training college was that I found, which I visited, of course, in my role as the sort of authority on English teaching. There were about a dozen copies of a volume called Bilingualism, brackets with special reference to Bengal. And this was published by the government of India in 1926. And the author was someone called Michael West. Now, Michael, this book proposed that English should be taught, but the basic question that it raised was, what is the local need, the relevant need for English in Bengal, in Bengal schools? And West concluded that this was the ability to read the language, not to speak it, not to replicate the behavior of native speakers, but that English as an educational resource for reading. And this initiated a scheme of simplified readers. And this was based on the notion of relevance. Right? So it was this, I mean, you asked me earlier, I think, about what educational experience or political or whatever had influenced my ideas. And this experience, both in Indonesia, in my attempt at teaching this literature, where it became clear that you could not simply transfer a concept of English literature from one context of situation to another, nor could you do the same with English. That there was a necessity to interpret these concepts in terms of their local relevance.
If your argument is valid, that you cannot just transfer, let's say, a concept in English literature, I guess it would be true as well in applied linguistics, that you cannot just transfer a concept in language teaching or applied linguistics produced and thought about in one context and use it in another teaching
context. Right. Exactly. This is I think that is the crucial point about applied linguistics. And it's not, the history of English language teaching, for example, is one of a failure to recognize fellows, a failure to recognize that what is English in one perception is very different from another. There is, for example, in the CEFR, European framework for, of reference. The assumption is that foreign languages are all alike in that they're foreign. They're all foreign, so they can be categorized. You know, that is a foreign language. But a language is only foreign in relation to one's own language. Languages are foreign in very different ways. In different communities. So Russian as a foreign language is foreign in a very different way in, for example, Ukraine than it is, say, in Madras, right, in Spain. Because each language, the foreignness of a language is associated with, well, as you will well know, it's colonial history, for example, who has spoken it over time, what, in Walloon's terms, what value it has, its symbolic capital, as he calls it, its symbolic capital, its economic capital, and so on. So that languages are foreign in very different ways. And English is foreign in different ways than other languages, clearly, depending on where it is being used and in relation to what other languages use.
So what it means, therefore, is this. If languages are foreign in different ways, the converse of this is this. Languages are mother tongues in different ways as well.
Yes. Yes. I mean, the local ecology, if you like, of a language is always different to a greater or lesser extent. One can't, it seems to me, assume that the same factors in the context of situation, what Firth referred to as the relevant objects, relevant content, the relevant participants, and so on, this interrelationship of factors is going to be the same. And I think that with applied linguistics, the crucial question is the ecological one. I mean, it's how does language relate to the experience of its users? If one is looking at the kind of experience, the problems that people experience, these are not language problems. They are problems which involve language. So to understand the factors that involve language, which are the factors in Firth's context of situation, essentially, this, if you like, is the ecology of the language in relation to other factors. Whether these factors have to do, I mean, this is why it's significant that the context of situation had its origin in the anthropology of Malinowski. How did language actually relate to other factors in a particular community? Now, if communal factors are always different because of religious belief, established values, historical events, historical memories, all kinds of factors enter into people's attitude to their own language and other people's language. The foreignness is, in a sense, ecologically defined, because it relates to factors in a different way. And therefore, it attracts different kinds of capital. This is where Walloon's notion of capital comes in. So the idea that there is an approach to language description and an approach to language teaching, which is transferable, must be mistaken. And yet, we've seen in English language teaching, for example, we have seen how an approach to language teaching designed by the Council of Europe for members of the European community gets taken over and adopted, not adapted, but adopted in all over the world. And the same is true of the more recent Council of Europe formulation of the European framework of reference.
But we now have accumulated in applied linguistics enough knowledge and experience to know that simply adopting some of these ideas and converting them into movement might not be appropriate. So my question to you is, why do we keep making the same mistakes all over again?
I think it's because of the the institutional pressures are such that they override any kind of academic inquiry. The other factors are far more powerful than what research might reveal. And so the Council of Europe, for example, their proposals are effective because they are institutionally supported, of course. I mean, there's the whole commercial enterprise of English language testing, for example. There are economic interests which are much more powerful than any other. And you can always find a way of interpreting academic findings in ways which are economically suited to your purpose. And this happens, this continuously happens. I mean, we've only got to look at the situation of the world at the moment to know that persuasion is very powerful if it has an economic basis. And also the basis of the sense of one's own identity. If one's own identity and economic well-being is threatened, then you're not going to pay much attention to any kind of ideas of tolerance or understanding. And this is, or in a way, I think that in a way this may seem harsh, but I think applied linguistics has been complicit in this. Because of the insistence that applied linguistics is essentially a disciplinary activity, not only disciplinary but interdisciplinary, and I've talked about this before, one can understand why applied linguistics, applied linguists, make a claim to be dealing with disciplinary concepts, and better than that, interdisciplinary concepts, because of course it's academically respectable, and it is therefore institutionally very powerful. So we have chairs in applied linguistics, and we have journals of applied linguistics, and we've got conferences in applied linguistics, and so long as this is persuasive, there's a disinclination and economically viable and helps with people's careers, which is also an economical factor, of course, that so long as applied linguistics offers a career, its professional character seems to matter less. So if you ask what exactly applied linguistics, and I've been asking you, previously in your notes to me, you said, you know, what has been your influence on applied linguistics? Well, I think my influence on applied linguistics has been more or less nil. I have been arguing for a long time that one really ought to define what are our terms of reference. And if you look, there are almost anything that has to do vaguely with language is called applied linguistics. Because it is, it sounds as if it's sort of it's down to earth and realistic and relevant, relevant again. So if it sounds good, you know, why inquire into its actual nature? So I think that this notion of, because it seems to me that if one considers disciplinarity, the point about disciplinarity is that it abstracts from everyday experience. The expertise of linguistics is not the same as the experience of the language user. It is an abstraction from it. And it rarely gets referred back to the experience of the language user.
Okay. Now I want you to help me solve is the wrong way. I want you to help me think through the current problem I am faced with. At the moment, I am the director of African Studies, and I also happen to have a joint appointment with the Department of Applied Linguistics. And I naively agreed to work out a dual title degree between Applied Linguistics and African Studies. Now, my question to you is this. If you were in my position, other than abandon the task, how would you proceed?
Well, I think that I would ask questions like, what is involved in African studies? Studies suggests some detached, and this again is a very old, anthropological and sociological issue. And it has to do with member categories and insider experience as opposed to outsider observation, right? Are we talking about third person data or first person data, right?
Okay.
The experience of people, or are we looking at them from outside and observing? So what do you mean by studies? And in fact, one could spend a good deal of interesting time looking at how studies, in the sense of looking at how people experience things and how their experience is observed and interpreted by the outsider, this seems to me a crucial educational issue. And so what do you mean by studies? And then, very much related to that, what do you mean by applied linguistics? How do you define it? What is applied linguistics meant to do? If it's meant to interpret the experience, experiential data of language users, and abstract from that generalities and categories, then that's one. That's linguistics, right? But if, on the other hand, you start with saying, well, if it is the case that applied linguistics is concerned with problems in the real world, then you start with the problems. And here, I think, although coming back to the context of situation, although Firth's context of situation is not at all adequate linguistically. I mean, it doesn't constitute a linguistic theory, right?
Yes.
Or even an elementary model of linguistic description. You can't use it. You can't operationalize it.
Yeah.
It is a very useful framework for identifying problems that people have. Who are these participants that we're talking about using language? What are they using it for? What are their beliefs and assumptions? How does it vary in relation to the effect that they wish to achieve with the language, etc.? So this is why it seems to me that for all its inadequacies, theoretical and descriptive inadequacies, that Firth's context of situation, it remains, it's a tease in a way, it teasingly remains really what applied linguistics should be about. But if you do that, you say that's what applied linguistics is about, you may well not get any funds, you may well not get anything accepted in the learned journal, you may well, in fact, not be invited to a conference, because all of these things are essentially, I think, conceived of as having to measure up and to be accountable to disciplinary criteria, not criteria of usefulness. And the crucial thing of relevance, I mean, relevant doesn't matter. I mean, we've got a very large numbers of people doing research in so-called applied linguistics, which is entirely remote. I mean, they don't start with the problem, they create the problem.
Anyway, thank you very much, Henry. Let me give over to Edwin, our moderator, and I think he will invite Jason and we'll continue with the conversation. Edwin, thank you very much. Edwin.
Thank you, Professor. And thank you, Professor. And so we can kindly post our questions in the chat box. And alternatively, if you would like to raise up our hands, you can use the hand raise function. And so I would invite Jason to ask a question, and then the questions can come afterwards. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you for coming today, Henry. I think everyone is thrilled to have you here, and I'm thrilled to be here and have the opportunity to talk with you a little bit. I'm going to just give a quick little story, and then and it actually ties into my question, and that is before we started the session today, we were talking and kind of getting to know one another. We never got to me in the line, and I was just going to remind you, I'm not sure if you remember, we met the first time at the second annual English as a Lingua Franca conference, and I can't remember exactly where that was, with my advisor, Lucy Pickering, at the time, when I was still...
Oh, Lucy, yes, I remember Lucy Pickering.
Right.
Oh, yes. I'm sorry,
so,
I didn't...
Yeah.
Okay, Jason, nice to see you.
Of course. It was an absolute pleasure. Again, also, I know at one point you and Barbara also supported me for a Fulbright fellowship, which I was unfortunately never able to realize. But that's a little bit of a history, and you've been kind of portraying today also a lot of history of your own life and your own experiences in applied linguistics, however we'd like to define that field. Over the past several years, I found myself being particularly interested more and more in anthropology and human history in general. Where do we come from? And that ties back to the field. There's the 2004 book you co-wrote or supported with Howitt on the history of English language teaching. And those types, I'm fascinated by these types of stories. So I guess my question is essentially, how important do you think it is for us, for those of us who would identify as applied linguists, how important is it for us to understand the history of the field, where we come from?
Absolutely crucial. I mean, the history is simply one dimension of change, and current variation is another dimension of change. So that, as L.P. Hartley said, the past is a different country. And so whether you're looking at different ways of thinking and different beliefs, values, and so on, historically, or across spatially, so to speak, now. I mean, there is, in a sense, no difference. The space and time, and if you go to various countries, you go back in time in relation to Europe, because they have very different ideas, very different assumptions, political beliefs, and so on. So that variation in the way, what I said, is the ecology of human societies, including language, including beliefs about language, vary over time and vary over space, right? And presumably when one is talking about southern epistemologies, you could say exactly the same thing as historical changes of epistemology, and it's the same phenomenon. And it essentially is because how we think is always partial, right? And it's always partial in relation to our own experience. So this is why it makes no sense, to my mind, to censor or to disregard as irrelevant or wrong ideas that people have in the past. One has to understand how they're located in that context of situation, right? So that censorship is not the answer at all. It's education is the obvious, coming back to, we need to be educated in the idea that there are no fixed, in the human science, so-called science, maybe, one can argue that in the physical sciences, and this is one of the difficulties about disciplinarity, we've assumed that the disciplines of the human society, human science, must replicate the same, be subject to the same standards and conditions of validity as the physical sciences. And I think that's a fundamental error. And we've tried to do it in linguistics. I mean, in generative grammar, I remember a time when people in Michigan who were trying to incorporate in the deep of the deepest of deep structures elocutionary force as a property of sentences, and first fell into the same trap. And that was one of his problems, that he was trying to think of the categories he'd identified in the college situation as the same, of the same nature as linguistic formal categories of linguistic structure. This is the difference, I think, between applied linguistics and linguistics. The assumptions and the accountability are totally different. So that, yes, we need to draw on concepts from linguistics, but recognize that these are partial, they are incomplete, they are indicators of where we would look in dealing with problems people have with language in the real world, where we might look, right, to clarify these problems. But to impose them need to be, this is what I call linguistics applied. So we are living in the past, and the kind of, we're only going to look at the events in Europe at the moment. I mean, the whole situation in Europe derives from the 19th century. You can't understand what's going on in Europe unless you understand the 19th century of Europe, of nationalism, of the formation of Germany, of the Russian Empire, the destruction of the Ottoman Empire. All of this is directly relevant to how people think and behave now politically. This is, I think, the crucial thing. And that's what education is about. Understanding precisely that, you know, rather than abstracting something and focusing on it as if it were somehow an entity in itself, separate. It isn't. It can never be in the human side. Maybe you can do that with molecules. I don't know. But you can't do it with language behavior or language or people, right?
Thank you so much, Henry. I really appreciate that. And I noticed some a little bit as you were responding there and earlier to our colleague Diane was kind of shaking her head a little bit. No. I think then she pointed out, I think maybe it was MIT, not necessarily Michigan.
I'm sorry, I beg your pardon. MIT. Diane.
Thank you. I think myself and others, we could ask you questions for the rest of the day here. But I know there's a couple other folks that have their hands up, so I'll step back and allow Edwin to continue the moderation.
Yeah.
Okay.
Ashraf, you can ask your question.
thank you very much, Dr. Henry Goodison, for taking us through this wonderful journey. I want to ask or to raise two points and I want you to reflect on them. I wonder whether you can reflect on your famous debate with Fairclough. because that actually debate was, you know, in some way, to use the word of you, Travis Lomax, he's here now because he taught us this course and that course and reflected on that debate. He said that debate was itself, you know, formative of the field, shaped the field somehow, your debate with Fairclough. And
yes.
Yes. And the second point or question is about the notion of the expert or the expertise. I remember in the beginning of the 2000, maybe the 2002, 2003, around that time, Baal tried to get involved in confrontation with the Home Office in the UK, rejecting the citizenship test. And the argument was the position which they adopted was critical position. I remember you intervened in that debate and argued that we need to adopt an expert position, not the political position. Because I remember you said, if we adopt the expert position, our voice would be heard, would be listened to. Otherwise, it would be ignored.
Yes, that's right.
How do you reconcile that argument for expert and the native speakerness? Because here, because the expert is based, expert notion is based on the native speaker notion. Being an expert is based on the notion of native speaker. So if you reject the notion of the native speaker, you cannot argue the case for being an expert. See the point?
To be an expert. Yes, but if the, yeah, yes. I didn't catch all of your question and the sound isn't terribly good. But the last point you were making is that if you get expert opinion, then this carries more weight than if you don't get expert opinion. And this, of course, an expert is an institutionalized expert. Right? An expert is an expert because they can show credentials. And these credentials are those ratified by institutions of one kind or another. In relation to language, the institutional view of language, I think, is that a language is a language and is defined by the conventional norms of the language of a particular community, right? This language is not the same as conceiving of language as a communicative resource. This view of language as a conventionalized set of norms of knowledge and behavior is how we've traditionally conceived of language. Language as a language, and this is how we have experienced language in our own in our own experience. And so we've been socialized into thinking of language as being an entity which is shared by a community, and so on and so forth. So an expert would be an expert, presumably, in being able to refer expertly to this, to the conventions and norms of that language. But surely the point to be made is that conformity to those norms, these conventional norms, is not the only way in which the resources of that language are actually realized. And this brings us to the English as a lingua franca, for example, which is the use of not a replication of the normalized conventions which define a language and which you find in dictionaries and grammatical descriptions, which are assumed to be the English or the French or the German language, but it's a use of the communicative resources potentially within this linguistic code, which can be exploited and explored in all kinds of different ways. So if someone is asked, well, is this correct English? The answer is yes or no in relation to these norms, these conventions. But if you ask, is it effective English? Do people get their meanings across? Do they communicate effectively? Do they relate to each other in using it? This is a very different question. But the expertise then has to change the concept of language from it being a conventionalized norm, a communal norm, to an open resource. And the problem is that that language has become institutionalized to, in many ways, disregard language as a resource and to prioritize language as a conventional communal entity.
Right. Thank you. But let me put this point in a crude way. If I present, sometimes I need to present myself to the government as an expert in linguistics to argue the case, for example, in the favor of a marginalized group, to defend the rights of a marginalized group, for example. I have to adopt that identity of an expert. But I think that's your position somehow in that debate, I remember. But by presenting myself as an expert to the, you know, in relation to the government, I'm setting a hierarchical relationship between a linguist and the lay person.
You're conforming to the requirements of an institution. I mean, I don't know whether you know the work of William Labov and his, where you will know that the official or the orthodox view of black of African American English at that time was that it was a deficient, it was a defective version. Rather, as these days people think of much of English as a lingua franca, as defective, deficient English, because it doesn't replicate the established institutionally approved norms, right? And so what Labov demonstrated was that there is a logic in non-standard English, that communicatively speaking, that people use the resources of English that they have at their disposal in all kinds of effective ways, which don't correspond to the approved norm. Right? So to the extent that Labov is accepted as an authority, right, with a different view of language, then one can hope that gradually the institutional view of language will change and that there will be an increased equality of education, right? Which is, and Labov in that respect is an applied linguist because he was looking at a problem and he was identifying the basic issues. He was drawing upon his disciplinary knowledge in order to make it relevant to this particular problem, right? To the extent that, and it's a very hard row, it's a very, very hard line to row. The same would be true of English as lingua franca. So long as the institutional view of language as being an established conventionalized code, which needs to be replicated, then, which is the assumption behind this is the institutional view based on this is what curricula tend to be based upon. So long as that view obtains, then of course, you're going to get users of English as lingua franca that do not, there are users of English as lingua franca which do conform to these norms, but there are a lot of them that don't, but are nevertheless perfectly capable of communication. Right? But they will not be recognized if there is not some kind of institutional recognition. Right? And so long as, I mean, so long as you've got this massive industry of testing and assessment and textbook production based upon the need to train people to pass the test. The economic, as I said earlier, the economic argument will win out. And the problem is it always does seem to win out. And other values, apart from the economic, tend to be set aside. We can see that on this broader scale of what's happening in Europe today, politically. The economic argument counts far more than the other. And the values that people say that they share are not any other values except that of commercial interest.
Thank you. Sorry, just to raise a last point, because and then I'll give it to Ward. You started your CV, your professional trajectory by talking about Edinburgh, you know, the center. And the feeling we got is that, you know, applied linguistics actually was formed in the center in Europe. Sinfri made an argument in Edinburgh, BAS conference. He said that that narrative is the global narrative. It emanates from the global southern literature or discourse. Sinfri's argument is that applied linguistics was somehow shaped in the periphery, outside Europe, and that trajectory gets erased in the dominant narrative. So how do you react to that argument?
So I have difficulty hearing. I'm sorry, I didn't hear. But I didn't hear what the argument was there.
The argument of Sinfri is that actually applied linguistics started in Africa, and then exported to the center, to the Europe. But the dominant discourse doesn't mention that trajectory. It always portrays the projects applied linguistics as if it was started in Edinburgh.
Yes, I agree. Yes. Because applied linguistics became an institutional disciplinary area of inquiry, right? And therefore was provided with the usual concomitants of any kind of institutionalized discipline. It had its standards, the methodological standards, concepts that were acceptable and those which were not. Many of the principles of inquiry taken over from the physical sciences. And this is what I was arguing before, that applied linguistics became institutionalized, it became a label for a whole range of different activities in which it was convenient to call applied linguistics. And the effect was that no one really felt it necessary to inquire into what actually applied, what it was they were doing. You know? So even today, if you actually raise the question, if you say to someone, you're an applied linguist, what do you do as an applied linguist? Right? And what does what you're doing count as applied linguistics? I think people would in fact find it difficult to provide a clear answer. And the reaction is one of impatience, actually. Why are you bringing that question up again, defining applied linguistics? We don't have to define it, we just do it. So you say, well, what is it? We say, don't mind what it is. You're being pedantic to ask exactly what the principles of your inquiry are. I mean, we know what they are, and we just do them. I think we need to be explicit. We need to critically look into the concepts that we take for granted, the ideas we take for granted. There's another aspect to this, actually. I don't know if you want to get into it, but the idea of conceptual appraisal of the basis of what we're actually doing, the conceptual aspect of our activity, seems to me to have seriously declined over, I don't know, the past 10 years. And now it's the methodology of inquiry, which doesn't matter what you inquire into, so long as your methodology is satisfactory, is clear, and is systematic. So that it doesn't matter what your findings explain, so long as they are neatly categorized. One talks about digital humanities, for example, and the digital humanities means how do we use digital means to do our methodology? Not as I would think we ought to do, to think about digital humanity. How has humanity changed in its behavior? How do they conceive of the world differently now? And we do. I mean, our communication is radically different from what it was before. So I think we should be concerned with digital humanity and not so much with digital humanities as, not so much, but in addition to, as a precondition of making relevant how digitalization affects our methodology of inquiry. We need to ask, what is our inquiry about? What are we explaining here? And how is our explaining sort of relevant to human life? And these are big questions, but it seems to me people don't ask big questions anymore, except people like Diane, if I may say so. I mean, I don't entirely accept the significance of chaos theory and so on. But I do recognize that it's significant to make this kind of inquiry, to think in this way, right? And I don't think we do, or at least not as, because we're institutionally controlled, I think.
So there are a couple of questions in the chat box, and so I want to ask.
Okay.
So the first one is from Mohammed, And so Muhammad is asking a question about how you would consider the role of English when thought, when it's taught rather in the third or post-colonial world. So he's asking questions around, would it be a liberator or an oppression, or as an enricher of native cultures, or as a destroyer of home cultures? And so that's where his question is.
Okay, thank you very much. Well, it relates really to what I was saying before about how you conceive of language. if language teaching, English language teaching means getting students to conform to acquire what is known as communicative competence, that is to say, to acquire the norms of behavior, knowledge and behavior of a particular native speaking community, then this is one way. If you impose that, as I was saying before, that is an institutionalized imposition, and I think is effectively linguistic imperialism, because you are in fact imposing a way of thinking and behaving, regardless of whether it's relevant or appropriate or of value to those you're imposing it upon. If, on the other hand, you think of English as a language resource, right, which therefore denationalized, you can't have an international language which is a national language at the same time, right? So international is denationalized language. And it's denationalized to become an adaptable resource which is available to anyone who acquires. And it needs to be therefore dissociated from its links with inner circle or even outer circle. I mean, these are different communal uses of language that have been conventionalized as such. But the language as a resource is available for everybody, so long as there isn't the imposition of norms of correctness, of norms of conformity, right, that are at the moment institutionally required by formal assessment. So, so in a way, it's a way of relating language, English, I talked about the ecology of language, of relating it to other factors in the community of learners, who they are, what they want the language for, how they wish to relate to people, what their attitude to their own language and to English might be. All of these are factors which relate to each other in the general ecological, as it were, definition of the role of English, right? So that in a sense, it's the decolonization of English is an ecologizing of English, to recognize how it functions ecologically within a context of situation. Again, we come back to Teofa.
Okay. Sangeeta asked a question, and I think it's related to what you are saying. She's referring to the last point in your discussion with Sinfri, and she's asking rather that if it, would it be different if the focus is on social linguistics instead of applied linguistics? So if the focus was on social linguistic or linguistic anthropology instead of applied linguistics, would the question or would the focus be different?
Well, it relates to the point raised earlier, I think, about perspective. Sociolinguistics can either be, and this also relates to the old anthropological conundrum of what reality are we capturing, that of the outsider looking in, or that of the internal participants, the insiders, because what you see from outside is not at all, as we all know, necessarily at all the same as what is experienced inside. Right? And it's like the ethnomethodologist notion of member categories. Right? There are things you that are described from an internal member perspective, and things that you describe from an outsider, non-participant perspective. It's what I call, you can either represent social life, including language, right, as a first person experience, or a third person observed observation. Right? The shift to sociolinguistics doesn't necessarily mean a shift to an understanding of applied linguistic issues, because applied linguistics issues, I'm arguing, are essentially based on the problems experienced by the insiders. Right? So that if you try and explain the experience of the insiders and try and clarify or resolve the problems they have by reference to disciplinary ideas, that's one thing. But if you convert these into data for disciplinary statement, that's a very different thing. And if you look at sociolinguistics, this is why I refer to Labov. I mean, what Labov is doing in his study of North Standard English, he's looking at an educational problem. And he's exploring and explaining this problem by reference to sociolinguistic ideas. Right? But you can, of course, also describe this phenomenon from an outsider's point of view, and it still would be sociolinguistics. I don't know whether, I hope that's relatively clear. Which is why when people say, well, applied language is about the way in which language is used in society. No, it isn't. That is sociolinguistic. But applied linguistics has to take a particular perspective on these data for it to be applied linguistics.
Yeah, thank you. So we still have a couple of questions, and a number of people have raised up their hands. So we might go beyond the 90 minutes a little bit, and I wanted to confirm if you would be okay with that.
Yeah, okay.
That's fine.
Thank you. And so Arthur Spears has a question, but Arthur, do you want to ask the question verbally or I should read it?
Well, I wrote it because I thought it would be easier to understand. There were some problems with sound quality earlier.
Okay.
Since it's written, why not read it?
Okay.
You want me to read it?
Oh, I can read it. I can read it. So what are your thoughts? Arthur is asking, what are your thoughts on how to contextualize English or other language teaching? And to what extent should a teacher be concerned with communicative competence as opposed to merely linguistic or grammatical competence? And the last is, what role do you see for phonetics in foreign language teaching? And to localize his question with an example, how would you proceed to say with a contract to teach English to future telephone agents in India? By telephone agent, he means persons who would answer telephone calls from business customers in the US, Britain, or New Zealand.
And I would interject that I'm just trying to get some grounding for myself related to Professor Widdowson's ideas about English teaching as a project.
Okay. Taking the point about the the phone calls, people answering phone calls, in the call centers. There is a certain specific routine they follow, this is their specific purpose, if you like. What is relevant to them is that they should enunciate clearly. And if most of the callers are from the United States, then of course it makes sense and it is most useful, this is the point, the most relevant, that they should articulate and enunciate in a way which makes them intelligible. And they can be trained to do this over a very short range of performance, because they're not expected to engage in social chat, but only to respond to very specific routine inquiries. So, yes, I don't say. As to teaching competence, I would, and I think others would, define competence in terms of conformity to a norm. And this is certainly the way Himes defines it. You recognize whether or not a particular expression is appropriate or correct or whatever possible in relation to a norm. And this norm is the communal norm, which is institutionally accepted. So teaching of communicative competence, like any other, like communicative competence, is the teaching how to conform to the particular way in which a particular community communicates, which has been sort of ratified by linguistic description and the institutionalization of examinations and so on, and curricula and so on. But competence is not the same as capability. You can, this is the point, that you can, and indeed learners do, we know that learners are very capable of communicating if only you let them do so. But you don't, because there's an exam to test, an exam to pass and so on. And in the work outside the classroom, they of course communicate in all kinds of ways, which don't conform to what the teacher tells them they should do. So the natural use of English, like any natural use of any resource, is very different from the way in which a language is represented as something to learn in the classroom. But of course, as I said earlier, institutional pressures are such that you have to train for the test, right? Because it's a dereliction of your duty if you don't, right? Because it's all very well saying, I'm letting my students, I'm developing their capability to communicate, and they're doing it through chat rooms and social media outside the classroom anyway. They're doing great. They can communicate very effectively and so on. But actually, they can't produce a correct sentence. If the exam requires them to produce a correct sentence, you've got to teach them how to produce a correct sentence. So the teacher, in a way, has to indulge in a double think. On the one hand, they've got the training objective to get students to pass the exam, which obviously the teacher has to take note of. And what I would think of as the educational objective of developing their capability to communicate, where you are greatly assisted by the fact that they know how to communicate already and are doing it, even in the language that you're supposed to be teaching and in which they may be incompetent.
As an afterthought, excuse me for asking that question. It just occurred to me, and I just saw that you're living in Vienna now, so yeah. You probably have not had the experience of interacting with a telephone agent. And actually, one of the things I was thinking about is there are lots of specific problems that come to the fore that relate directly about to how one might go about teaching English. But I was trying to localize and give a specific example in order to bring out the details of your template or your methodology hyphen theory in terms of teaching English as a second language, and to give some grounding in my mind to the very fundamental issues that you brought up. What is the context? And also, what are you teaching it for? On a higher level, are you teaching it for oppression or liberation? Or what is the goal in the teaching of English as a foreign language in a particular social and cultural context?
Okay.
Yeah, I just want to say that. That's one thing that I had not had in mind when I asked the questions, but
okay.
I'll leave it there. But thanks.
Okay. I mean, in a way, I think that the goal is developing a process. The teaching of competence has an endpoint. You know what it is that you've got to train your students to do to pass the test. But the development of capability means the process of using the resources of a language, whatever resources you've got at your disposal, to get your meaning across, to communicate. Right? Mm-hmm. This is very difficult to test because basically you're investing in future activity beyond the test. I think an educational objective, but it's an objective which develops a capability process, a process whereby you are capable of communicating. But the problem is that it's not readily testable. You can't measure it at the end of the course because most of it develops beyond the course. But you, at the same time, that's what I was saying, the teacher has to have both in mind. One could say that allowing students to use language as a communicative resource, including using their own language, because they already have communicative capability. What they don't have is communicative competence in English, but they have communicative capability in language because their own experience of language, their own language, they know how to commit, and they make use of these this capability when they extend their repertoire by using English as a resource outside the classroom. And that is only to be welcomed. But the problem is that you can't easily test it. And institutions require tests, measurement, categories. Yeah. Are you a C2 or are you a B1? Institutions require human categorization. That's how they tick.
Thanks a lot.
Please, because of time, with all due respect, please let's limit our questions to one and minimize the follow-up. Arthur, did you want to say something?
No, I just wanted to thank him for his response and et cetera.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Maya has a question. Maya.
Thank you so much. In your response to a previous question, you've made a distinction between English and ELF. My question seeks to better understand your position via linguistic imperialism and how to counter it. So English, I see English as a lingua franca being complicated by English being a dominant language economically, scientifically, one might say culturally due to globalization and so forth. And one might even say that ELF is directly caused by such dominance of English because the movement is happening in the direction of ELF, of English, you know, to create ELF, and not in the direction of the marginalized or less dominant languages. So you said that the ELF agenda is anti-imperial and that you subscribe to this position. So to better understand this, so as part of an anti-imperial agenda that has long-term economic and epistemic justice at its heart, wouldn't we want to shield non-dominant languages, at least in the context of universal primary education, in order to slow or counter a shift to ELF? And I didn't use English, I used to ELF. Actually, it's, because I kind of, I'm saying it's tied with English being dominant. And a tie-on question in general is that whether you see ELF as an anti-imperial notion in as distinct in the domains of speech versus literacy, and by extension to literacy development versus spoken language learning and development. So what about ELF and literacy and all of that and linguistic imperialism?
Well, it's very interesting and very broad, wide-ranging question. I think that English, there's a problem with, of course, very term English. I mean, it happens that as with other languages, English, the term is both a reference to a community or communities of speakers as well as to what they speak. Right? But we know that there is no direct correspondence. So you don't have to be a Spaniard to speak Spanish, right? You don't have to be English to speak English. But nor do you have to behave like an English speaker, a native English speaker. You don't have to be a member of an inner IATA circle community, which is your communal language, to use the language for intercommunal purposes, right? To relate to other people and so on. So the problem will always, and the idea that somehow language, a language, has to be defining for a particular community, which was, of course, politically the basic idea in the 19th century, nationally, but is also what we ourselves are brought up to believe, right? I mean, we are socialized in a language, not in language, in a language, right? And then we find people are socialized in another language. And as we're socialized, we, of course, relate the language to all kinds of beliefs, values, cultural notions, et cetera, et cetera. It all gets intertwined. And in the consequence, the language acquires all kinds of peculiarities, historical traces of language, words that no longer exist, of structures which no longer are generative in the sense that, you know, you've got to learn them as chunks, right? Or a language, an historical document, is full of all kinds of strange and curious things which we learn, right, in our particular community of language because we're socialized into these. But a lot of them are totally non-rule governed, right? And the problem is that how do you dissociate this historical conventionalized language from a language in general as a communicative resource? How do we extract what is generative and productive from this massive sort of this very bizarre structure that we have been socialized into? So for me, we don't want to go into this, but I make a distinction between the normative language, the language which you find described in grammars and dictionaries and so on, and the virtual language, which is that part of a language which is still productive, which a set of encoding principles that are still creatively used, which is why language changes and develops over time. And it's this virtual language somehow that is used can be used for international. In other words, you can deconventionalize the language, denationalize the language as a resource. Now, it's a very tricky thing to do because, as I say, languages have all of this baggage of social communal identity and upbringing and so on that go with it. So it's not easy. But in a way, one can think of, I don't know, you can think of, for example, the Industrial Revolution, the invention of the steam engine, right, happened to be in Britain, right? But then it was taken up and used elsewhere. Or the automotive industry, for example, taken off and become something different, adapted to the life in Japan or the United States, wherever. Right? So that, like, in a way, English as a resource, one might almost call it English with an I, you know, English, not English, is the resource potential of English Big E, which is the way we tend always to think of English, is in the Big E way. And linguists talk as if this were the only English. And if one talks about a dictionary of English, that's what it is. With all the quirks and quiddities and warts and all, it's all there. Phrases which are no longer productive, idiomatic expressions, quirks of terminology, and so on, all there. Because it's the language. But that's not language as a productive resource. That's something better. And English is a lingua franca. As we, this is what you're capable in languaging, if you, which is not the same as being competent in the language, which presupposes that there's a norm which is describable and which is there, and which, if you want to know what English is, go to a dictionary or go to a grammar book. That's not what English is, for English is a lingua franca. It's a different phenomenon. Therefore, I mean, but I know that as soon as the term English, it must be colonialization. It must be English dominating other languages. But which English are we talking about? I think it's English is the conventionalized normal language. That is where the linguistic imperialism comes in, to impose that language. That's the problem.
Yeah.
Sorry, and then so this is does ELF live in the speech zone for you, and not in relation to literacy and literacy development? If we teach it in the class, can we teach it in the classroom? I'd love to hear your thoughts on this.
Sorry, I didn't catch the last thing you said.
So does ELF for you, is it a strictly oral communication?
No. Okay. No,
so
it is.
When you, no, so I mean, a, it, let's go of that grammar and that dictionary when it's taught. Like, how would one teach ELF?
Well, I think that I don't think you can teach ELF as a set of formal properties. Right? You can teach standard English as a set of formal properties. Right? Because the ELF is a communicative phenomenon, not a linguistic, essentially a linguistic. It's linguistically realized, but it's a communicative phenomenon. And the idea of using the resources of a language in disregard of the conventions of that have been established in your community is very common. I mean, this is what literary writers do. Right? A poet in English, that's what a poet does. Right? If you look at some of the of a poem in English, right? There are all kinds of funny, odd things about the language, right? Because poets know how to, I mean, we're all poetical in one way or another, and we all come out with innovative expression, which are not warranted by the code. Warranted by the code, but have not yet been encoded, right? So I can get a by hook or by crook, for example, right? That is a fixed phrase. I've got to get it right, because if I get it wrong, you know, I marked as being a non-English, but that's not English, right? And it's, so if I say by crook and by hook, for instance, which is entirely possible in the linguistic code, I can do that. I mean, by land or by sea or by land, this is not marked as either one or the other, but by hook or by crook it is, because it's an historical remnant, right? But we know how to use the resources of the language to change this and to develop new expressions. I mean, it happens all the time. We're constantly coming out with different ways of saying it, which is why I said earlier on that the historical development of the language follows the same kind of basic process as the spread of the language spatially, because other people take up the language, change it, and so on. My favorite example is in Indian English, you can prepone, right? And this is in Indian English, this is standard. You can postpone and you can prepone, right? But when it was originally coined, this is an innovation. And this happens all the time. So what is the source of this dynamism? It is that there's something in the language which is usable as a resource. And that's what how the elf develops, by exploiting this resource. Okay. So that, anyway, that's it. And we, Barbara Seidelhofer and I have talked about this elsewhere. So.
Heidi, please, you can ask your question. Brian, I don't know if I'm saying the name.
Okay, is that me, Heidi Burns?
Yeah.
Thanks for recognizing me. Hello to Henry first.
Hello, Heidi, how are you?
Long time associations, it's great to see you.
Indeed.
Thanks very much for your thoughtful presentation. I obviously was particularly intrigued by your intellectual biography. Lots of things that I can relate to and agree with. I also found good reminiscences in your treatment of the dangerousness of expert behavior when you served as a respondent to a perspectives issue I did in the MLJ on the proliferation of handbooks.
Oh, yes.
And the dangers that go with that, clearly identifying it with economic realities where we as researchers are just as much participants as we are victims of the whole affair. So it goes both ways. I would like to relate back to your comment of just how difficult it is to critique some of these things, particularly for any of us who, to a significant extent, are insiders and profit from it, so to speak, and at the same time are uneasy with it. I had the opportunity recently to look at the webinar that Diane did on complexity theory, where you, of course, were also our participant. And to me, the larger intellectual environment that we're talking about, that you referenced as context of situation, and of course one can expand that in any number of ways, seems to be particularly well served by complex dynamic systems theory. It is essentially a relational way of looking at things. And since we are talking in this context of this particular symposium and the folks that are organizing these events, what to me seems to be taking place is a gradual decentering of imperial notions of language. You refer to them as nationalism of the 19th century, but we can take it much broader, the imperialism of English and the British Council being part of it. There's no doubt about it, continued with the CFR. And what's taking place now is a gradual decentering of this, or wording it positively, a much, much more relational, contextual way of understanding, something that you has emphasized over and over again, and I love it, language as a resource. So instead of teaching language as a normed system, we would be interested in teaching language as a resource for meaning making in particular contexts of situation to bring all of this together. And that, of course, poses responsibilities, ethical responsibilities, lays out ethical responsibilities on the part of researchers, even as it lays enormous burdens on teachers, who, of course, are teaching in an institutional setting. And so how do you deal with this dynamic way of thinking of language as a resource in an institutional setting, which almost inherently has a normative aspect to it?
Yeah.
That, to me, is one of the key issues that the field of applied linguistics needs to look at, all the more so as we are now simultaneously moving some of our understandings of the nature of language and language use away from a Europe-centric to a much more globalized environment. And I think it is that which needs to be foregrounded. And as a larger opportunity for that kind of critique in a positive sense, I see dynamic systems theory as a particularly intellectually and ethically, more morally, environment for having that kind of a discussion.
Okay, well, I think that the dynamics theory, systems theory, is a perspective, but it's not the only one. I think Diana would accept that. And one of the dangers is that, as so often in the past, and you mentioned the difference between researchers and teachers, that applied linguistics, I think, because of its claimed interdisciplinarity, which makes it sort of academically respectable, at the same time distances itself from the actual problems that people encounter, like teachers. Right? Mm-hmm. And I think we have to accept that really applied linguists are sort of talking to each other. Right? They are a kind of academic elite. And the difficulty has always been, how do you act, as you point out, how do you actually establish this relevance link? Right? And in language teaching, how do you, because teachers, as we all know, are highly suspicious of applied linguistics, most of them. I mean, they often think of applied linguistics as being sort of armchair armchair sort of speculations. And in many ways, they're right. I mean, applied linguistics, theories of applied linguistics, things like the communicative approach and even translanguaging, I think, you know, it becomes popular and everyone sort of jumps on the bandwagon without really understanding the implications of what they do and without really understanding how you operationalize these ideas in classrooms. Now, my own view is that the most educationally effective way of teaching a language is by teaching language. That is to say that you allow the use of all languages that are available to learners for them to use. Initially, the purpose being that they achieve communicative outcomes because there is some motivation for doing so. And then gradually focus can be brought onto a particular language perhaps, but as a subsequent step, rather than presenting the foreign language as having nothing whatever to do with their own experience of language, and therefore you create a foreignness in the foreign language, which doesn't have to be there. If you think of it as language, which they are already capable of. That would be my view. But, you know, in relation to institutionalization, teachers are going to say, curriculum policy requires them to teach a language. There it is, English on the timetable four times a week. French is there on the timetable five times a week. So, if we've got a subject, we must define it as a separate subject. And it has its textbooks, and it has its exams, and it has its teachers. That constitutes the subject English or the subject French. And I think the likelihood of this changing in the immediate is remote. So the only thing I think that we can hope for at the moment is that, two things. One is that one needs to support teachers in their training endeavor to get students to pass the exam, right? Competence teaching is here to stay because it's institutionally approved. Yeah. But at the same time, and I think good teachers have always done this, allow learners the latitude to be individuals as well and to draw upon their own capability. Supported now more and more, I think, by what they can do with the language outside the classroom. Right. And recognize that this might serve as a motivation. And then one might be able to say to students, you know, that, okay, we're enjoying ourselves and we manage, my goodness, we're communicating with each other, we're relating to each other, and the reality of the classroom does correspond to the reality outside when you're in the chat room and so on. But unfortunately, we are also teaching English for a specific purpose, ESP. And the ESP of English is getting people to meet the requirements of the exam. So part of the educational process has to be the training of learners to pass an exam. And I don't think we're going to be able to get away from it. But I think at the same time, it is possible to provide this more educational dimension, this development of capability, to motivate.
I can add to that, you know, we're all captives of our own terminology. And to some extent, of course, you have set some markers down on where we might rethink. I would agree that competence is actually an indicator of a much more normed way of thinking about
language. Yes.
Capacity, yes. Capability is more likely to capture the situatedness that moves toward meaning making as its primary goal rather than adherence to a norm, much like Diane's distinction in her Beijing keynote. Acquisition is as a terminology is associated with a certain way of thinking about language that we by now have learned to, at the very least, suspect of some problems, so to speak. And I think competence is another one of those, because it harkens back to a notion of you are competent if you adhere to certain norms, which we now appreciate as not telling the whole story, and certainly not telling the story as it now needs to be told in a much more decentered way, where beyond the empire, whether it's British or other imperial or nationalistic thinking, there are all these other places where multilingualism is the norm rather than national monolingualism. And there again, it is teachers and teacher education that need all the support we as a professional community can give them, because that's where the action is. And need I say more, in the American political context now, this is where the battleground is right now, between ideologies that are completely unwilling to accept these emerging and emergent realities and those that would prefer to stick to the power relationships that have been established.
Good.
Thank you, everyone. So I'd like to hand over, even though we have questions in the chat box and all that, because our time is fast spent, we couldn't get to all the questions. Sorry for that, but I'd like to hand over to Prof. Makoni for the final words, and then Vishna would conclude the session.
I'd like to thank everybody for taking part in this exciting forum. I would like to say that what was interesting towards the end were the discussions about the ideas, let's say, about applied linguistics, ideas about language, etc., wherever they were coming from. Over the last 18 months or so, or in actual fact, over the last couple of weeks, in this particular forum, or related to this particular forum, we have published, I can't remember how many books we have published. The most recent one is called Southernizing Sociolinguistics, Colonialism, Racism, and Patriarchy in Language in the Global South. I think I got my copy yesterday. And then I think about 2 weeks or so ago, we published the Routledge Handbook of Language in the Global South, with Souths with a plural to capture the plurality of this. And then there is another volume that we published called Decolonial Voices, Language and Race. What is interesting about this specific one is that it's not only a text, it has got a video equivalent to this. So that if somebody in the Global South, in Asia, et cetera, and they want to, they can't afford to buy the book, they can at least be able to afford to watch or listen to the book. And at the moment, we are in the process of working on a series of these particular books. And what I have learned from all these conversations is that there is a hell lot of scholarship that is relevant to some of the topics that we are dealing with. For example, when Diana is talking about complexity theory, et cetera, et cetera. another way you could get to into a discussion with her is if you go and read some of the work by people like Lewis Gordon, Jane Gordon, etc., who are philosophers in African studies. You come up with a completely different understanding of what you think Diana Larson Freeman is trying to say. In other words, the more we read widely, the more we are likely to come up with a completely different understanding of the nature and the challenges that we are faced with. Thanks, Henry. It has been a pleasure listening to you. And let me give over to Vishna to tell us who is coming over next week.
Thank you so much.